Greetings and hallucinations to all you folks out there. Got a game for you today on The Mesmerizing Paradise. This is a 4v4 that I have casted before. Has an absolutely ludicrous crap ton of reclaim in the center. Reclaim for days. And, of course, navy and land and air are all vitally important on this map. It does kind of have the neck thing going on like Settins does, but it's a very wide neck where you can actually have a good battle. A couple of bays that you make good use of. Hover units are very nice to have. And then wide open waters, which towards the later part of the game can actually be a decisive factor. You've got 7 or 8 or 9 mass extractors out here in the islands, 2 in the back for the air player to expand into, and varied roles. I say air player, but this guy, I've seen these guys go navy, I've seen them go air, I've seen them go land. Pretty much anything goes on this map. So, without further ado, let's go ahead and let me untie my tongue out of the knot into which I have wrenched it, and let's try this again. Let's introduce the players, and then we'll jump into the action. On the northern side, we've got Nikarth. That is a 1600 going blue UEF. Then we've got Zell. He's a 1200 purple Cybern. Followed by Momo, 1500 rated player, yellow UEF. And last but certainly not least, Sun. Going brilliant orange Aeon. He is in the back slot. Looks like an average Joe's rated game. 1,000 through 1,700 rank. Speaking of 1,700s, we've got Government Cheese going white with the Cybern. Then we've got Selvid's red. He is taking Cybern as well. A 1,000 rated player. Very well balanced game, this one, honestly. Ghost Ronin, blue Seraphim. He is another 1,400, and then in the back, we've got Haina going Aeon. Brilliant pink-purple for her, him, whatever it is. I say her because it's pink, but honestly, that is a terrible assumption to make. And yeah, Aeon faction choice for the back player as well there. ACUs are going to clash in the middle. You'll have 2 to 3 ACUs, depending on the game here. Point defense is a useless feature because it just denies you the extra reclaim that you would have had if you had reclaimed instead of built point defense. And generally speaking, there's going to be a huge land clash here as everyone tries to wrench control of the mass away from the other team. Looks like 3 ACUs are going to get to the front earlier for the left side or southern team. Let's see. Yeah, it can be either. Left, right, top, bottom. Either one works. Bravo, Alpha Charlie. Somebody's got the renaming theme going on. Guys are going to just suck up as much mass as they can, except Government Cheese is going to suck up damage. But whatever goes for you, bud. If you're a glutton for punishment, I will not deny you your awesome stance. Looks like mid-reclaim has been pretty well cleaned up. One thing you don't want to forget about is this stuff. Up on the top, there's actually build area on the mountains. You can have an artillery war across the valley, and there is some reclaim up there as well, so don't want to forget about that. And holy cow, it would be terrible to have a bunch of ACUs go up in flames here, but I think everybody's going to separate pretty well. Just don't get too greedy with the mass. If you start walking in too far, you could very well bite off more than you can chew and die. Actually, blue is the one that's wandering way over here. He's sucking up all of the mass from the other team while these guys are just walking and walking away. That is hysterical. Cheese is getting a little bit low on health, though. He needs to really think about vacating the premises, although Momo is not much better off at the moment. We got a drop coming out. It's going to drop an engineer up here on top of the mountain range. That is inaccessible from the sides. You actually have to drop an engineer there. And that transport is going to run off and drop the mid as well. So rear slot's actually going to get a lot of reclaim this game. That is a odd thing to have happen. Zell is going to take a nosedive in the HP arena as well. He's going to get chased into the water. It's going to leave the rest of the reclaim to be gotten by Cheese and Selvids. Although really there's nothing left here. And Bravo was able to snatch a lot of that mass away from the northern team as well. Let's go ahead and take a look at what we got going on here. We've got 2,400, 2,000. Yeah, it looks like most of these guys are hovering around. Ah, Momo got 3,000, and holy hell, Ghost Ronin just about to crack 10K reclaim. He definitely wins the MVP for the early game. He was sucking up mass left, right, and center. Got the vast majority of it. That is amazing. He definitely gave the reclaim edge to his team. We got a transport headed off to the left here. Looks like Hyena is going to... Hyena. Should I be pronouncing that, actually enunciating the hyena, or is that Hyena? Not entirely sure there. I'm going to call it Hyena. Call it like it sounds. Hyena is pushing a transport off to the left side, going to snag this island and hopefully drop a couple more places up there. It would be a shame not to. And then this engineer is going to claim this mass in the back. And a spot back here, there are a couple of large rocks to reclaim, but overall it's just two mass extractors. A little extra build area, you can throw down some power and air production back there where it's not in any danger of being destroyed as it would be up here. Also a good place for naval staging, should you so desire. I've seen that put to a lot of different uses over time. Looks like Bravo, not Bravo, that's Ghost Stronin, and he's renaming his ACU and screwing with my head. He is in the middle of an upgrade, but was stopped. Purple is going to do a drop. Where it's dropping, I do not know, but it is going to be sighted. Ah, he was trying to drop the mass over here. Someone has the naming mod. Happy Dancing, White Death, Psycho, etc., etc. Those rocks are actually worth a substantial amount of mass if you grab them. And this as well. You can see these guys are just now dipping into that, using up the mass that they had in their reserves from the reclaim war in the center, and finally dipping a toe into that reserve. Zell's gonna venture back out onto land. Not sure where he's headed. Straight across. That is a brave passage. The one thing I do not like about this map is the stupid cloud right there, because it makes the terrain go away. That is slightly annoying. Zell's gonna get chased back into the water by Cheese's units. How dare you poke your head out. I'm gonna run back in, taking a little bit of artillery fire, but not too terribly much. Down to 3,800 health, but there is a T1 sub there, so we might have a problem in the middle here. The, T1 sub production. 100% T1 subs. So land units on the land, and subs in the water. Mantis or subs, by whose hand do you wish to die? None, he says. I will reclaim this sub with my mighty arm. Half the health gone in one shot, but you need to get a move on there, bud. You're under 3k health. T2 gunship coming out to help. That is going to do a small amount of damage, but not a whole lot. One T2 gunship is pretty effective versus T1 land, but when you have this kind of spam, you're going to need, I don't know, 5 or 6 to actually make a serious dent in that before the anti-air comes up to the front. T2 gunships are pretty effective at dealing with T1 land. They're very fast, they have a good amount of fuel, and they do a decent amount of damage. So I think they have enough health to hang around and kill off T1 mobile anti-air unless it's just in tremendous quantity. So we've got another drop coming in. Hyena is pulling in. Looks like it's going to be on the wide open desert here. This has a very varied terrain. Very varied. We've got desert, we've got mountain, we've got jungle, ocean. Pretty much all of our bases are covered here. All we need is some red clay and we'll be complete. That drop is going to come in this way. It is pinged, it is scouted, but it is going to be able to touch down, I think. Question is, can it get... Holy cow. Ah! Death by land units, I think. I will have that in the fast action replay because I completely and totally missed an ACU death. I've not done that in quite some time. I've been near ACU deaths, but I have not totally and completely missed one in forever. Hopefully you can forgive me. At least you'll be able to see it in the cam, and I'll put it on the screen or something if it's not clear what killed it. So we've got the T1 land fact down. That is complete. That means we've got a foothold over here, and that will be much harder to kill, that expansion there. Hopefully he'll be able to kill off some mass extractors and make it worth his while for having that over there. That was the mid player for the northern team that died. That's going to cause a major disruption, but we had a drop. Engineers are already in place reclaiming the mess. Going to rebuild those mass extractors at some point. and hopefully they will be able to make good use of the double eco. That is a 1600 rated player, so he should be able to do things correctly. One can hope. One might not always be correct, but one can hope. Yeah, tanks moving in to deal with these incoming mantids, whatever they be. Hopefully that will get denied. I would hate to have this game end in T1 phase on this map, because that would be kind of ludicrous. Red actually claimed these islands out here. That is kind of odd. I also would have left the transport there and island hopped with that engineer to get the rest of those mass extractors. I think that would have been wise. Maybe he's coming back to pick up these three and go drop them. That may be the case. So many land factories. Hyena is definitely going for T3 air, throwing down a third T2 generator, probably going to be getting RAS soon, and that will allow him or her to shift to T3 air. This expansion failed, unfortunately. It killed one mass extractor, and that is it. T2 gunship's going to swarm in. Sun is making very good use of those gunships. He's going to kill off those factories. One cool thing about gunships and Aeon factories, not all of the factories work like this. Cybern has the obstructions overhead, so it's kind of a little bit harder for gunships to get at it. But gunships and Aeon factories don't get along very well because the gunships actually shoot the center of the factory, which kills the unit building in the factory. So if you have multiple gunships and multiple factories, if you put one gunship on each factory and then the rest to kill the factories in sequence, you can factory lock a whole bunch of Aeon factories at once. Really nasty strategy. You can basically prevent him from building any tier of unit, because as soon as it starts building, zap, enough DPS to restart the building process. So your opponent is wasting mass and not building any units, which allows your gunships to be way more effective. Cool strategy to employ. So the push here is not going to be very effective. Selvids is going to get all of his units killed off. We've got T2 tanks moving in, and some flak. No! Don't fly over the flak. We're about to see a whole bunch of interceptors go down, I think. And the flak is choosing the worst possible interceptors to target. All of the lone wolves that are hovering around are getting targeted instead of the main group. I think had those been manually targeted, probably half those interceptors could have been killed if they've been paying attention. But as it is, most of them are damaged. Some of them are almost dead. That is no longer a healthy air force in the slightest. Oh, nastiness. Ghost Ronin has got the TAC pack for the Seraphim Commander. He's got the T2 TAC Commander. That's going to allow him to fire off some rapid shots at the Eco. I've already got a T3 mass extractor. Why are you building T3 without capping them? Probably all of the reclaim that was available just a little while ago. Still got a T1 here. But all of these are unfortunately going to go down. Interestingly enough, he could kill Nekarith because it would take two shots. The reload time is faster than the regen that he has left to reach 12,000. And he's in the middle of an upgrade, so I find it highly unlikely that he would move. Could have gotten an easy kill right there if he had just fired at that blip in the ocean. I believe that ACU is close enough to the surface to take the hit. Yes. But it is too late now. He's on the move. TAC launcher headed up north. Where is it going? The naval factory, I think. Is the Cooper going to finish? Is it going to finish? Nope. I don't think so. Kaboom! Not really going to do the damage necessary to kill that factory right off. Another interesting thing with TAC missiles, if you're manually firing at a naval factory, ground fire your TAC launcher right here and drag it over on top of the unit right there. It will kill the unit in the factory and it will damage the factory. So you're killing two birds with one stone. The most literal pun ever issued by man. And that will allow you to factory lock, waste build power, prevent him from building units, all kinds of nasty business. That is the best possible use of your TAC launcher. Right now, he is... Nope, he's not launching at it anymore. He's launching at mass extractors. My bad, peeps. He did build tack defense. Maybe that will prevent further incursions, but nope, we're going to be firing away at the naval factory still. He did switch to a cruiser being produced, but that is not going to be built anywhere near soon enough to prevent those tacks from hitting. It was kind of sad, but you get what you get. Got a decent little naval engagement going on down here. This is a UEF cruiser firing away at some Cybern units. I would be taking this and focus firing it on that. Again, focus firing the side producing the unit to lock that factory, because that is critical. If the factory is facing you, you can just fire at the factory. It impacts the front side of the factory and it will let you kill the unit inside. But if you're facing the rear of the factory, you actually need to ground fire the other side in order to pull off the effective factory lock. But we do have a Salem class destroyer out that is going to allow Cheese to kill off these T1 units and hopefully push back this cruiser before things are damaged too extensively. There's another destroyer coming out for Momo, but unfortunately the UEF just don't match up to Cybern in the T2 phase. Bit difficult. Orange is dropping these islands out here. Not sure why he is. Red is already here, but he is going to snag one island, so good for him. You can get an extra mass extractor. He's actually got a lot of mass extractors at the moment. He is ahead in eco by 4. He is 164 to 160 for Hyena, and pulling a substantial amount of power in addition to what Hyena is pulling. Got 8.4k to 5.5k in the power grid, and looks like he's undergoing his final resource allocation upgrade and getting ready with that T3 air factory to pull off some T3 units. Maybe we'll see an early strat, who knows. Selvids, T2 P-Gen sitting on that, and a comfortable amount of eco, although not excessive. And some hover units trying to come in. Plateau getting cleaned up by these gunships. Excellent use of gunships, this whole game by Sun. I love to see raiding with gunships. Gunships are, for the most part, underutilized, and they're just really cool units. Why wouldn't you build them? Those are going to clean up that nicely, and then chill out. Just going to take the afternoon off, sit back, relax. A lot of hard work killing today. Just going to take a break. And we've got Cheese still sitting on his 2 destroyers, although that one is about to die. He does not move. Nope, still targeting the factory. 330 health. Definitely not the best place to be. Got mobile missile launchers firing away here at the mid. Lonely Ilshava, poor thing's gonna die. Out there on the front lines all by himself. Oh, nope, there he's gonna move. That would be the worst possible way to lose an Ilshi. T1 bombers coming in. This is an awesome opportunity for T1 bombers here. We've got all of these units packed in. Damaging 6 units, kills 4, and lays down damage on 2 T2 units. And more damage coming in. That is an epic shot. Way to go, Sun. Harassment is key, my friends. Always harass. We have a strat bomber out. Actually, by the person with the lower income at the moment. Sun is taking his sweet time getting T3 units out. He has 1 ASF, but 1 ASF is all you need to kill a bomber. Hyena has 3 and a strat bomber, so Hyena may actually be able to protect this strat bomber and go do some damage. Hopefully he can wreak havoc on a lot of stuff, because this double eco position right here is going to get nastier and nastier as the game goes on. Right now the southern side does have a pretty distinct eco advantage across pretty much all slots, except for air, and air is kind of close. They are within 20 mass of each other, although the northern side is ahead on that one. T2 gunship's gonna come down and succeed in killing off the T2 factory. This is crucial right here. The T2 factory HQ going down is gonna prevent any more destroyers from getting into the water. And this is a critical time for that, because the UEF Navy is still building. The only advantage that Cybern has over UEF, naval-wise, is early push. And if you can't succeed in that early push, you are doomed. Absolutely doomed, I say, to fail in the late game. As soon as T3 rolls off this factory, your game is pretty much over unless you've already won it by sheer force of will in the early game. Got a demolisher moving out now. T3 Mobile Artillery is going to park in the mid, an excellent tool for raining fire and brimstone down upon these groups of units. When you have bottlenecks like this, you can see, actually, that's squad movement as well. Squad movement is not a good idea because it packs all of your units together in this nice, tight little bunch. All you have to do is aim the T3 Mobile Artillery at this center one, and you can damage 9 units at a time in that formation. It causes horrific damage. Brick's gonna kite their way in here. Gonna hit the pillars from afar. Don't walk in close, please. Don't walk in close. You just need to kite around and you can destroy the entire group without taking so much as a scratch. Not a single damage on any of these, and they're already up to 4 or so kills apiece. And now it's going to take a hit, but from mobile missile launchers, not from actual games. And GG, why calling GG? There's a strat bomber there hitting him. Don't call GG. You can walk to the water, silly person. Don't give up so easily. Dodge. Run in circles. Although I gotta say, the air situation is not looking good for the northern team. Ow, I just cracked my knee on my desk. Hopefully that did not interfere with the mic too much. I'll go back and edit that little spot. Strat bomber is going to be shot down by the cruiser. Momo doing an awesome job of saving himself with that cruiser. Also parking his ACU right next to the cliff so that any bomber that drops, about a third of the passes are just going to miss completely because the bombs are going to impact on the top of this. Nice save there. These bricks succeeding very hard. We've got 4, 8, 4, 12 kills. And then a new brick coming up from the back. All of those pillars just retreating, continuing to feed these bricks veterancy. Once you get bricks out on the field, T2 is pretty much done, unless it's Ilshavas, and even Ilshavas start having a hard time unless you got a lot of mobile shields with them. The only thing that rules harder than a brick is a Percival, as I'm sure we all know. UEF destroyers are parking up here. They're going to be able to knock out this frigate pretty easily, these two frigates, but... Ah, Coopers, too. Good job on the Coopers. I am being slightly unobservant right now. I do apologize. I had a extremely long work day, and I am somewhat mentally fried, but I want to get this cast out so I can get it uploaded and out to you guys tomorrow, because I do not want to give up my casting schedule again. For a few weeks, I was a little bit bad about my scheduling there and got lax. And I'm finally back in my groove, and I don't want to quit now. Tutorial cast on Tuesday, normal cast on Thursday, and then 2 games live casted. One, like an actual cast of a game, and one of me playing on Saturday with questions in between. You should definitely tune into that. I'm going to do a little mini infomercial for it here right now. It is 6 p.m. Eastern U.S. time. I am here on YouTube doing a live cast. It's on my channel. All you gotta do is go to the channel and hit the watch button on the main thing, and it'll pop up at 6 p.m. You can ask questions. I answer questions about anything that you want to ask, watch the game, and interact with all the other guys that are around here. Nice little air engagement. Orange made up some ground on that one. He was at a pretty severe... Government cheese quits? No, that was actually a kill. Holy cow, I missed a second one. Ah! I gotta stop talking. I am doing so badly at this. Thank goodness for the fast action replay cam, because otherwise I would be totally lost in this game. Wow. Alright, these 4 bricks up the top here are doing a splendiferous job of wiping this base clean. Unfortunately, I have passed within reach of the ACU. ACU is going to land a couple of overcharges and eliminate those guys, but they have already done a whole lot of damage. Percival's starting to roll off the factory here. Those are going to be able to put a stop to the advances of the bricks as soon as there are 2 or 3 of them out and available. Alright, now that things have somewhat calmed down. Again, 6 p.m. Saturday, live cast. It is a great time. Had about 50 people there the last two times and had some good questions, good answers, some people interacting, and Pink is going to take the win on that. Winning air very hard. Still a little bit behind in score, but that is going to give him some leeway where he can use the air control to exercise force against the other team. Expanding is going to be a little bit hard right now. It is made easier by the fact that Red had already laid down land factories over here. It is made more difficult by the fact that there is a cruiser sitting just offshore pounding these targets into oblivion. And you know what? Building TMD is not a good idea versus UEF cruisers because they fire in a concentrated missile pattern and each one of those missiles has two health. So building enough TMD to stop UEF cruisers is actually a losing proposition. You're going to sink so much mass into TMD that you would have been better off doing hover or torpedo bombers to kill the cruisers or something else. But in this instance, this is actually a really well-composed navy. You've got the frigates for health. You've got two Coopers to defend against any subs that might come around. You've got two destroyers, which are going to do a load of damage to T1 units and also offer your mainline bombardment. You've got a shield and a cruiser. The shield is going to protect your cruiser from being torp bombed right away. It allows your cruiser to kill two or three times as many torp bombers before it dies as an unprotected cruiser. So that is an awesome little mix right here. Momo is doing a fantastic job. He's got a second cruiser online as well. There's an Aeon cruiser online that is going to deny some of that attack damage. But for the most part, these two cruisers are going to be able to kill all kinds of things without really being impeded. Wake up, Bennett. Wake up. Alrighty then. Still T1 bombers. Oh, nuke. I see nuke in the chat. Where is there a nuke? Haha. And it is loaded. Looks like we got a nuke defense going up. Do these guys have defense? That is the question. No. I don't see any. We got defense building right there, but it is by no means finished. So this nuke rush is going to pay off. We got a 23-minute nuke, which is respectably early, but not super early. He didn't sacrifice his eco to build it, but it is early enough that the other team is completely and totally unprepared. So here we go, up, and away. Have to follow this guy across the map, see where he's off to. Looks like for Red. Yes! Right on top of the Monkey Lord. We got a transport coming in for the ACU. ACU is going to get pulled to safety, but that is going to be a hard hit to swallow right there. Going to lose a quarter-built T4 and several T3 mechs, it looks like. One. I thought he had more upgraded than that. 1.5. Could have probably done a whole lot better nuking the back end. Could have killed all five of those powers in one shot. But you hit where you can. A nuke is a nuke. If nothing else, it is demoralizing for sure. Red's base is purged. Only got a few T2 mechs to come back to. Does he have? Yes, he has RAS. So power's not a problem, and he has some mass extractors. He'll be able to rebuild without much problem. But the issue here is that he was the main frontline player. He was building bricks with which to deny the northern team, and now he has no more eco for bricks, which is going to present a fairly serious issue in just a moment, because we do have some Percivals and more being built by the northern side. Nekarith is building them as fast as he possibly can and not really building a whole lot else. He's throwing down a T3 power generator to protect himself from stalling, and also he has a nice little Clinkhammer formation on the shore that's going to be able to reach across the neck here and the bay and protect him from any incoming fire. It will not, however, protect him from cruisers. There are multiple Seraphim cruisers coming around, but it looks like those are headed around towards the back. They're not going to be hanging around in the neck of things. Going after the orange player, and you know, I really don't blame them because they got to get rid of the nuke. Nuke is already half built. It's going to run through another cycle here in just a moment. got just under half loaded, but I think Hyena is in a Mastol. Yes, this nuke defense is not going to load unless he can sustain a positive eco. Sun is building at maximum speed, actually running plus mass, which is awesome. You always want to have mass in the bank when you're building a nuke so it builds as fast as possible. He would actually be able to nuke the air player, and the air player could not do anything about it, but I don't know if he will, because that's a gamble. He doesn't know what we know. He just knows that there is a nuke defense back there that's been built for a while, and if he wastes his nuke on it, that could potentially lose him the game. That's a lot of mass to throw away and a long time to wait for the next nuke, so he may end up nuking something safer. Got the cruisers coming into the back here. They're going to kill off that expansion. Let's see. Have we got any? Nope, no anti-nuke over there. Could nuke that. There are quite a few T3 mechs over here. Four, to be exact. Could wing four and get the power. Nope. Power being control-K'd. Going to reclaim that stuff. But I still think the best possible location for this nuke to hit is going to be in the back. Looks like Hyena is finally solved the eco problem. He knew that he had to get positive to get that anti-nuke loaded. He's looking at about 55%, whereas we're 85 or so percent on Sun's nuke. So he may still have time to get it in there. Restore is moving up from the south. You see that ping there? Don't think these are going to be able to do a whole lot of damage, but we've got T2 gunships moving down for Sun. I think these may actually be the same T2 gunships that have been here the whole time. Nope, some of them only got one kill and some of them got none, so that is a fresh batch. I'm going to try to kill off this T2 mechs, and nope, all dead in one pass from Pink's ASF. Sun is going to run to the right, trying to kill off these restorers before they can kill those mass extractors, and I think he is going to succeed. In come the ASF. One pass, three kills. Well done, my good sir. Ah, lollygagging. No, no, shoot the T2 mass extractor. Don't kill the storage. Storage is stupid. And now it's too late. Well, that was a missed opportunity. So sad. So many TAC missiles. Looks like we've got five cruisers over here. Pouring TAC missiles into this base. Sun trying to get a GC online. And his nuke is complete. But yeah, I think an anti-nuke would load right before it impacted. We'll have to see where he launches. Oh, nasty business in mid. As I mentioned a while ago with the Percivals, now that there's no more bricks flowing to center, Percivals are going to be a problem. And they are now a problem. Got a couple of mobile anti-air out here, but that is not what Selvid needs. He needs to get out of dodge while the getting's good, because Percivals are on the way and they can walk faster than ACUs can. Looks like we're mass producing T1 bombers over here. It's actually not a bad idea. T1 bombers can be pretty dang effective at whatever you want to throw them at, especially if you have pesky little engineers reclaiming things you don't want them to reclaim. And go in there and deal with the problem. So we're not going to launch the nuke. We're going to save up another one. That is fine. That is fine. Whatever you want to do with it. We will hang here in suspense while he decides. And yes, the anti-nuke is loaded. From here on out, it is downhill for the nuke launcher now that the anti-nuke is loaded. Anti-nuke is going to pretty much load all the time before the nuke does. But there's a freshly built anti-nuke way over here that is not loaded, so he could potentially still hit that area. Did he really? Nope, there's the cruiser. I was about to say, did he really kill the cruiser with T1 bombers, because that would actually be awesome. I was about to say sad, but T1 bombers killing a cruiser, a dedicated anti-air unit, that is awesome. Badass little bombers. restorers moving in. Those are going to start laying into these Percivals, but there's a fairly good contingent of mobile flak in the back here. A word to the wise, if you have plenty of ASF for air control, it is actually better to build T2 gunships damage-wise, because the T2 gunships have far more DPS per mass than the Restorer do as far as ground units go. Additionally, you're going to want to take your Restorers and target the flak immediately rather than taking fire while you're throwing your measly, paltry, tiny amount of damage at these Percivals. It is not going to end well. Finally, retargeting. T3 mobile anti-air as well. Knocking that down pretty quickly. You can see the unit model here. I don't think I've examined the UEF one real closely before. Whoever created the T3 mobile anti-air did a really good job on the Cybern one especially. The Cybern one just looks tremendous. Got a little scorpion vibe going on here. I love those things. They did a pretty good job on all of the models, to be honest. Well done. I'm not sure who designed the models for them, but they did well. T1 bombers falling out of the skies under flak fire. And ASF engagement missed right there. Got a strap bomber coming out trying to deal with the Percivals. It's going to immediately get shot down. Orange is pulling in to an air turn. Pink pulled a horrible turn. Oh my word. Orange is going to pick off the stragglers over here, fall in behind the pack. That was brilliantly maneuvered. He had fewer ASF, but he actually managed to pull in a good turn and end that. Looks like he's got a second. No, he's going to falter on that third turn, and now he's losing again. Better disengage, buddy. You're not going to catch back up again. Should have quit while you were ahead. Taking wing fire from these cruisers out here. He's now just going to dive all in and go after the strat bombers. It's like, screw you, ASF. I'm not playing your games. I'm going to go after these strats, because we all know that's the real target. Pink completely bypassing the ASF group again. Pink not doing super well in his air game. Unit stacking up on the shore here. This is another thing I noticed. The southern side has complete and total naval domination, but they're not building. I would have been spamming, gone for the T3 naval factory and then started spamming the torrents, because the T3 mobile missile ships are fantastic. I cannot overemphasize that. Can pretty much reach the entire map from the water on this map, from some point in the water or another. Yellow moving up with his couple of destroyers. Momo is going to make an attempt at breaking this navy, but I don't think he's going to be super successful. There's an awful lot of cruisers in that mix, but there's one. One destroyer, almost entirely cruisers, but the cruisers are going to be able to retreat. Yellow's going to retreat in the face of a clearly inferior navy, which I don't really understand. Blue's going to get away scot-free. And Orange doing his absolute level best to outmaneuver Pink, and I think that he just succeeded to some degree. He now has a few more ASF. I'm not sure what to think of Orange as far as air goes. He makes one good decision and then one really bad decision versus his, as far as his micro goes. It is kind of odd. But, Soul Ripper. Nice. He's inconsistent. Hyena is consistently making somewhat correct but fairly sloppy turns. Orange is just like bullseye one and missed the next one by a mile.
Strategic launch detected.
Not completely sure what's going on there. But in the end, he did manage to win air. So that is what matters. Orange is now in control and he's going to be able to pester this gunship to get to death. Soul Rippers die so easily to ASF. It's not even funny. We got this GC moving in now. It has successfully traversed the map from its home over here in the back end. We got the nuke coming across, the continual flow of T1 bombers, a second nuke. Oh wow, this is not going to end well. And now Blue is pitching in with ASF. I think we can safely say that the Northern team has won this. By the nukes. There's the defense fire. Oh no, there's two defenses loaded. It is not over yet. Thought he was still on one, but he does have two. So total waste of mass there. Alrighty then. The southern side, like I said, has such complete, utter, total naval domination. I'm amazed that they're not taking advantage of this more fully. Got another GC here. War of the Galactic Colossuses. There's Strat Bombers coming in. Where is he going? Possibly for build power. Or for power. Either one would be a good target. Gonna fly over and not shoot anything. It's an interesting choice. This Navy, were it employed, could kill off this relatively easily. And then this up here, it's a pretty even match. So the Southern Navy, the Southern team pretty much has Navy in the bag at this point, should they choose to take it. And not taking it, I think, is slowly but surely eating them alive. Got a whaler out here trying to kill off these frigates and the battleship and everything else. Seraphim frigates don't do much anti-air damage, but when you're talking about a unit in the air for this length of time with that many frigates to kill, then it is going to make a dent in the hull. Also, cruiser. Selvid is getting the teleport upgrade. That is what he's getting. He's trying to decide on that one. Strat Bomber's coming in. Going to kill that mass extractor there and lay down some damage on the T3. Need to hit it one more time to shoot it down. ASF immediately jumping on the case to shoot that thing down. Looks like we got one crash, and the second one is down as well. But not before it gets off that Strat Bomber. It's like a giant middle finger raised in the air. You can shoot me down, but you will never stop me. If only it had a unit to kamikaze into. The only thing more beautiful than that would have been to kamikaze an ACU for the final blow with that Strat Bomber. That would have been throwing a middle finger in the air, like calling in fiery pterodactyls to stick their middle claws into your eyes while thunderbolts strike you. But yeah, I don't think that's ever happened in game. This GC is progressing into the base. It did manage to survive against the other GC thanks to accompanying units and a Strat Bomber, I believe, if I remember correctly. It may have just been a Strat Bomber, but it seems like there were a couple more units besides anti-air with this. Regardless of the cause, this GC is down to 13k health with only 8 kills. This ACU may actually be able to kill the GC if it can walk the distance in time. It is against the clock. Doo-doop, doo-doop, doo-doop. Nope, not fast enough. Well, that was sad. That was incredibly anticlimactic. But I guess that's what's happening when the GC is not also walking towards the ACU. You just can't walk close enough in time. The giant beam of death will incinerate you, and there's nothing you can do about it. It's just like a slow plod into oblivion. Thankfully, there was another GC there to clean up that mess. And is going to be able to make some progress now. But now there are T3 air units coming in from all three players on the northern team. Strat bombers, ASF, restorers, T2 gunships, T1 bombers, everything you can possibly throw at somebody is coming. And it does not look healthy. Still with the naval control, though. Not for long. Blue has put a lot of production into hover. He is going to turn some riptides out to hopefully run over this small contingency of Navy. And yes, three broadswords. Those actually do a pretty respectable amount of damage. I wonder how long it would take one restorer to kill a Galactic Colossus. I don't think any of us have enough time in a night to actually sit there and watch that happen. Also, I might be slightly delirious from lack of sleep and being worn out from work, so you'll have to forgive me for being, number one, unobservant, and number two, kind of rambling off into random sidetracks. I just desperately hope that this is not painful to listen to. T1 bombers coming in, gonna try to drop on some of this build power, but ASF are just going to knock them out of the air. Pretty good distance back. Kudos to Hyena for actually watching where those units were going and extending his ASF to kill them off, but I think this right here is going to be a mistake. He's going to end up wasting DPS on the T1 bombers that should have gone into the ASF. A good turn execution from Orange, and pretty much all of the ASF are mopped up in one turn. That was a really bad turnaround. Now if he can get out of reach of those aircraft carriers, he will be golden. He'll have enough ASF to defend any combat units that he chooses to produce, and he'll be able to produce the other team into the ground. Again, if you're building gunships for the sole purpose of taking down units, T2 gunships do more damage than T3. And with the air control that Sun has, I would highly recommend shifting entirely to T2 gunships again. Because, yeah, he basically owns the sky. Also, he has a superb amount of ASF. And yes, strategic Hyena is calling it game over, and I kind of tend to agree with him. We got strap bombers pulling around the backside. It was looking like a very good game for a long time there, but the end is the end. You cannot help it. Question is, what is going to kill Pink? Coming in for the nuke defense. Actually not going to kill the nuke defense. Got to get that second pass in. The nuke draweth nigh. Ghost Ronin's going to commit suicide out in the water. And here comes the kill. Just before the shield recharges, there goes the anti-nuke. Nuke descending upon the Navy. That hurts to watch right there. There is so much. He's trying to get his ASF out of the carriers and away before the nuke impacts. Kaboom. All of that production gone. Oh, the GC is too tall to submerge in the water. All these gunships are going to slowly whittle its health down until it dies. And there it goes. Glub, 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 glub. Now I can drown. Goodbye, teddy bear. If you don't get that joke, watch the unit tutorial. I just put one out on Tuesday, and if you don't know how to play Aeon, you definitely need to go look at that tutorial. Percival's coming in from the back here. Gonna play a little game of Wreck the Base. Were those airdropped? I think those actually walked all the way around. That's actually an impressive feat. Percival's take a long time to walk. I don't see any transport, so I'm going to assume that they did. An ACU in the back here. One anti-nuke loaded. Not that it makes any difference. That one is not loaded. But he is not long for this world. I do guarantee you that. Gonna bump up the speed here. Oops, wrong button. There we go. And get to the end. Hyena's gonna take his death gracefully, walking into the Percivals. And that is the end of it. GG to both teams, but especially to the North. Nice recovery from the early ASCU death. Excellent use of air units from Sun. He played very well. I cannot emphasize that enough. I was ripping on his ASF micro a little bit, but as far as constant harassment with T1 bombers, good use of raiding with T2 gunships, and just controlling the map to his own benefit, he did phenomenally well. 3 stars to you, my good sir. Actually, that sounds bad. Typically, people do out of 5 stars. I'm going to say 5 stars to you, my good sir. And then the Southern team, they actually had it. I think they could have won it even after Red's base got obliterated because of the naval control. But when you don't exploit the strengths that you have, you're gonna end up losing the game. And it's sad when it happens, but that is what happens. Alrighty, guys, I'm gonna wrap that up there. Sorry if this cast was a little bit on the downbeat. Like I said, I am not 100% there mentally and stamina-wise. But hopefully I will be back on top of things in time for the Saturday cast. Don't forget to tune in 6 p.m. Eastern U.S. time. Live game cast, a standard game that someone sends me in. By the way, people, please send me replays. I need some replays, good replays. And we'll do a question and answer time, then I'll play a live game with you guys, and then we'll do some more questions after that. So we will be having an epic time. Come and join us, 6 p.m. Eastern U.S. And with that, I am out of here. As always, guys, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.